thank you for who you are. Jesus, so I magnify you. We glorify you, Jesus. We glorify you, Jesus. We glorify you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, God. Thank you, Lord, that you are Emmanuel, God with us. Oh, Lord, you came and lived amongst us, Lord, and then you died for us, Lord. Oh, we thank you, God. Oh, we thank you. Praise you.
Did you know that your baby boy
Yes, you are, Lord Jesus. You're all I want. You're all I want. You're all I need. Oh, how you're all. You're all I want. You're all I want. You're all I want. Oh, just worship. Protector God, we are under the shadow of your wings, Lord God. We dwell in that secret place with the Most High God. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, God. We worship you. We praise you. We're so thankful for who you are and why you came, Jesus. over us. We glorify you and magnify you. We say that you are God and you alone. We praise you, King of Kings. Oh, Most High God, we glorify you. We worship you. Take everything, every part, Jesus. Exalt you, Jesus.
Praise your name, Jesus. Glory and honor to you. Bless you. Bless you. Glory and praise to you, Jesus. We exalt you. Father, I thank you. Jesus was born and he lived. And he demonstrated many things, including authority over all devils. And Father, I say, as the shepherd of this local flock, that the predator will not take the people of this flock prey. That the predator and none of those in his pack will take the health of the people in this flock. Will not steal or destroy the children or the marriages or the finances. I say that the predator is defeated. Totally and completely defeated. And he will not see victory in any way, shape, or form. We are the sheep of your pasture, Father. And your presence is strong in this place. Father, this morning, may the glory of the Lord rise among us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. All right. Be handshakeful. Good morning. Or, depending upon where you live, good afternoon. Good evening. Whichever. Thank you for joining us, either live or archived. We appreciate you taking this time and being a part of this church family. Praise the Lord. And man, last week we had a wonderful Christmas banquet Sunday night. Man, that was great. Food was tremendous, the decorations, everything. And we had, somewhere between 65 and 70 people show up. It was excellent. So thank you to everybody who was involved with the setup, the cleaning, the decorations. The food preparation, thank you for helping us eat the food. It was tremendous. So thank you. And, you know, Brother Neil has said, well, why don't you just come back here and do it here every year? It's like, well, you know what? We just might, because that's a great location. a great location. Then, of course, you know, if we all moved into the building, it'd be so easy. Just take the elevator, go up, there we are. So, thank you guys. Thank you so very much. Give you an opportunity to give this morning. And again, I thank you for your giving. I say that a lot, but I mean it. You know, if there's one thing, one area of life where Satan can maybe have the most impact as far as our emotions are concerned, it has to do with money. Because, you know, there's a song that says money talks, and it does. You have to use money to pay your bills. I mean, somebody has to use money to pay your bills. That's just the way it works. And I find it interesting how a lot of people talk about, I'll say it like this, you know, all the blessings of God and didn't have to pay a thing. Well, maybe you didn't, but somebody did. Somebody had to use their money to pay for whatever it is that you have. God wants us to be at a place of understanding how to depend on Him. Whether it's personal lives, business, ministry, whatever it is. But at the same time, He wants us to learn how to be sensitive to Him when it comes to our giving. And that's not just a matter of here, and it's not just a matter, you know, Christmas time, people, the giving mood and all that, but it's year-round. How God wants us to use our money, how He wants us to steward it. He doesn't want us to be in debt, so therefore, you know, we need to really seek Him for wisdom concerning our indebtedness. But then furthermore, when it comes to how we use our money above and beyond, years ago, I was, I guess you could say, kind of like everybody else, in that there was a time in my life I just wanted stuff, you know, just wanted stuff. But now I've learned to reevaluate what it is that I want. And I've learned that it's better to talk to God about what you want than tell God what you bought. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay, how much do we need? I can remember years ago when I worked for a construction company, we built really nice houses, big houses. One house we built, one house in particular, and I won't tell you, it's here in the area. This house was over 7,000 square feet. Big. And it was for husband and wife. The kids were gone. Just the two of them. And he happened to be an executive for a major corporation. And the reason he wanted the house that big was, well, any time that family would come in for the holidays, I want to make sure we've got plenty of room for them. That's like, well, okay, yeah, over 7,000 square feet. I mean, man, you must have like a whole battalion coming in. I mean, how many kids do you have? So, I look at that and it's like, okay, well, that's what he chose to use his money for. But then how does that apply to us? How do we steward what we have? One of the things that God wants us to do is to prioritize what we do with our money. That means seeking Him first. You know, God, I want this, I want that, and just, I don't know, whatever you want, you know, make the list. But then go back and ask, okay, this is kind of like what I want here, but God, what do you want me to do? Quite frankly, based on what I have seen in the lives of Christians who had the money to spend, I have seen, not in all, but at many, I have seen a tremendous amount of abuse. So when it comes to money, God, I want money, I want more money. It isn't that He can't give you more, but would you be a wise steward if He gave it to you? That's a major question. One way to answer that is, how are you managing what you have? Well, when it comes again to giving, that should be a part of, I guess you could call it, our budget. But then again, we need to seek God over what we would develop as our budget to make sure that we're being wise with our money. But I thank you for your giving. because every person, whether you're at this church or those of you watching, you know, the church that God has put you in, all believers have a responsibility to give responsibly to the church where they're attending. And that's totally between them and God. So thank you for your giving. Those of you who are a part of this ministry, thank you, wherever you are, for your giving as well. And I just, again, declare that all our need is supplied. Personal, ministry, all our need is supplied. As God moves and blesses us according to those incredible riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Praise the Lord. So, those of you that are watching, any offerings you are going to be sending in, you can do so through PayPal. The link is there at the opening page of the website, or the mailing address is there as well, and any checks or money orders, just make them out to GCC. So everybody go ahead and stand as the ushers are coming forward. Thank you, ushers. Sean, would you please pray over our offering today? Amen. Praise God. Thank you. You may be seated. Now, next week, next Sunday, the 22nd, we will have service Sunday morning, but we will have no service on Sunday night. I know this time of year, a lot of family things take place, and we want to honor that. We want you to have time with your family. So no service next Sunday night, and then obviously, Christmas being on Wednesday, there won't be any service then. So enjoy this wonderful Christmas season. Praise God. This past Sunday night when we had the banquet, I messed up big time because I had printed the 2020 calendars and I forgot to mention it and put them out. So anyway, they are on top of the cabinet in the rear of the sanctuary, the rear corner of the sanctuary. As you're leaving, please, you know, go ahead and take one, but if you had friends or family at the banquet, and you're going to be seeing them anytime soon, why don't you go ahead and take a calendar for them as well? And just let them know you were supposed to get this at the banquet, but Pastor messed up and didn't put them out. And because it's kind of a neat thing to give those out. And again, the picture is one that I did take earlier this year. Praise God. All righty. You know, I've got something here on my little list for announcements. It says green. I have no idea what that means. And I'm the one that wrote it. So anyway, if I happen to remember at some point in time in the future, I will let you know. But for right now, let's go ahead and get into the message. We're continuing in this series entitled Living Faith, and today is the fifth sermon, which means that if you haven't heard parts 1, 2, 3, and 4, it will be to your benefit to go back and listen to them. One of the things that I have found when it comes to teaching a series, some people don't listen to all of it. And when that happens, questions come up. Well, how come you didn't teach about, you know, such and such? And, well, I did. Well, I never heard it. Well, it was in part 2. Well, you should have taught on it. I did. It was in part 3, part whatever. You need to go back and listen to it. Well, I don't have time for all that. Okay, you just told me a lot. Praise God. So anyway, I do encourage you, you know, go back and listen to this. And the reason for it, what, you know, another series on faith. Well, the way I look at it, sooner or later, something is probably going to sink in. And some of us are going to start living by faith the way we ought to. Because, let's just be honest, there's not one of us in this room, that including me, we're not getting the faith results that we should. The kind of faith results that are described in Scripture. The faith potential that we have. You know, it's not happening. And quite frankly, some people could take this to an extreme and, you say everything we read in here, but no, I'm not saying that. I mean, I don't know that I'm ever going to need to walk on water. So, I'm not focusing on getting my faith to the place to where I can just walk on water. No. I mean, if that happens, it happens. But it's everything else. It's not just signs and wonders. It's everything. Every aspect of what faith can do. And, one of the things that we've learned so far is that faith either works the way the Bible says or it doesn't. And if it doesn't, then God is a liar. And if that's the case, how in the world do you even know if you're born again? How do you know that you're going to heaven? If faith does not work the way the Bible says, how do you know what you can and can't accept? Well, faith works the way the Bible describes because God said so. So therefore, anybody who has this idea that, this faith and confession stuff, it really doesn't work and so on and so forth, and the word and faith, I don't believe that. Okay, what you're telling me is, until that changes in you, you're never, never, and I mean never, ever, in 1,000 eternities, you will never truly live by faith. Because the true message of faith, the word, and confession is in Scripture. There it is. The precedent is there. If somebody else messes it up, well, that's up to them. If somebody else teaches it wrong, that's up to them. But why are you basing your faith on what you continually hear from pulpits all over the place? It's supposed to be based on what you see in the Word of God. So when it comes to what we believe concerning faith, the Word, and confession, and how the three of those work together, it's supposed to be on a contextual use of Scripture. Now, if you're not going to do that, I don't know what to tell you. But it's the same thing for, prosperity and healing and, everything else. That same principle is true. So when it comes to faith, faith is not, it's not some magical incantation. Faith is not some mystical power. Faith is not some science fiction come to life. It's just not. Now, okay, here's what's interesting. How can I put this in a way that somebody's not going to be offended? I just don't know that I can. Okay, there are a lot of Christians. Okay, before I say this, everybody to just look at me and just say, I promise you, dear Pastor Jim, I will not be offended. Okay, you said that. Do you realize that Christians could learn a lot about faith by watching Star Wars?
I said, I'm offended. I lied when I said that. I'm out of here.
Now, seriously. When you go through the Bible and you start reading Jesus, our example of living by faith, all right? Totally dependent on God. Totally dependent on the leadership of the Holy Spirit, the moving of the Holy Spirit, the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit. Totally dependent on that. He's our example. Do you remember those times in Scripture where it says something like, and Jesus perceiving their thoughts? Yep. How many of you have seen Star Wars? Your thoughts betray you. Okay? Now, and the things that happened that Jesus did by faith, all right? You see some of those kind of things reflected in Star Wars. I don't care if you're a Jedi Knight or a Sith Lord. The stuff that they did with the Force. squeezing people's... Well, Jesus never squeezed anybody's throat. What I'm saying is this. The concept for what you see in those movies, literally, its point of origin is the Word of God. You say, I don't believe that for 1 minute. I don't believe that. Well, what do you... Satan will twist anything that is truth. So if he can, you know, what he doesn't understand is that if you have Christians and they say, oh, that Star Wars stuff, you know, I don't want to have anything to do with it. Okay, that's fine, really. That's okay. No condemnation there. However, if you say something like, all that stuff that is portrayed in those movies is nothing but a bunch of mystical, magical, whimsical, whatever. It's like, hold on now. Hold on. The starting point, whatsoever you believe in your heart, speak with your mouth, you shall have. And that is the Word of God. Now, it's not God's fault that somebody twisted all that concept and put it into a movie and made good people and bad people and lightsabers and everything else. What I'm saying is this. This stuff that's out in the world, whether you call it good or bad, whether you call it entertaining or condemning, whatever you call it, truth is the foundation, and it's been twisted. And see, this is why a lot of Christians get put off with the whole concept of faith, confession, and the Word. Well, that stuff is just, and that's just, okay, but what does God say about it? What does God say about it? And so when I get into Scripture, and I see Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and I see what Jesus did. Jesus didn't need a lightsaber. He used the sword of the Word. Get this? Jesus did, and then he said, if you believe in me, the works that I do, you shall do also. And I don't need the force. I need the faith. I need the Word. That's what I need. Now, because there's been so much wrong teaching about faith, and many of us have probably heard it over the years, that stuff, if you sit and listen to it and listen to it, like, okay, for me, I grew up hearing, healing's not for today. Healing's not for today. Healing's not for today. Then I get over in a church and they say, well, healing's for today. Like, well, now, wait, I don't know about this, you know, because I've always heard. Then I see people get healed. Okay, wait a minute now. Let's reboot our belief system. Healing must be for today. Because even though I was raised to believe that healing's not for today, there was no way you were going to convince me Satan is going to do something good and heal people. So then this healing must be coming from God. Oh, and okay, please, let me back up a moment. Please don't think I'm telling you you need to watch Star Wars. Okay, I mean, the Lord just kind of brought that to my mind. Okay, I'm not saying do that. I'm not. If you haven't seen it, don't worry, you don't have to go watch it. You got the Word of God. That's all you need. Jesus is our example. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That's Jesus part one, part two, part three, and part four. This is all you need. Now, some people might say, well, yeah, but Brother Martin, you know, you talk about faith and you talk about, you know, doing the works of Jesus. And I just don't know about, I mean, look at all the things he did. Look at the miracles, and I don't know. Well, Jesus is the standard, all right? He's the prototype. He represents our potential. Because when we get born again, we have the same life that he had when he was here on the earth. We get filled with the Holy Spirit. We're getting filled with the same Holy Spirit that he was filled with when he was here on the earth. When the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is the one who administers the power. So the power that was administered through Jesus is the same power that can be administered through us. So it's all the same. And some people might say, yeah, but it just seems so out there. I mean, look what he did. He raised the dead. All right, hold on here. Let's think of it this way. Maybe the full potential represented by what Jesus did is just too hard for you to get a hold of. I mean, maybe that's just beyond, okay? Well, how about this? How about if we just, like, shoot for halfway? In other words, instead of raising the dead, we'll raise the half-dead. I mean, the people that are so sick that the doctors say, well, we don't think there's any hope. So they're not dead, but they're half-dead by medical definition. All right, well, let's just fix those folks, okay? And instead of getting the blind eyes to see, how about if we just minister to people and get them healed of nearsightedness or farsightedness? Follow me? We'll just get it halfway there. And the people that, you know, man, I don't know, are some of these folks deaf? I mean, deaf people? Okay, you know what? Then how about we'll just minister to people so they don't need their hearing aids anymore. Yeah. What'd you say, Brother Martin? I said. Do you follow what I'm getting at? If the full potential right now is just too mind-boggling, then let's go for halfway. Let's accept, all right, well, maybe raising the dead, yeah, I'm kind of having a hard time with that one, but yeah, the sick folk. You know, the folk maybe that have had a terminal diagnosis. All right, yeah, I can see where, let's do that. Okay, fine. You know what? That's a start. Because once we start seeing those things happen, all of a sudden, guess what? We're going to start realizing and believing, yeah, you know what? The other 50% is a reality as well. We can see that too. The bottom line is, we have to work on this to see it develop, and the potential is revealed in Scripture. Now, when it comes to this whole aspect of faith, when you're born again, the potential is there, but the fullness of the development is not. Now, we realized, and we went in Scripture, and we saw, you know, Romans 10:17, where it says, you know, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And I shared with you how that Romans 10:17, hearing and hearing by the Word of God, you know, faith, and all, that's not enough. And some people might say, well, now, wait a second. It says right there, Romans 10. I know what it says, but remember, we have to leave things in context. And over there in Timothy, the Apostle Paul wrote to him and said, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for our doctrine, for our correction, for our reproof. All Scripture. So then, when it comes to the whole subject of faith, I can't simply go by Romans 10:17. I need to find out what else Scripture says about faith. Well, I know it does say faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. But when we get over to Matthew chapter 13 and Mark chapter 4 and Luke chapter 18, we see Jesus giving us the story of the sower sows the Word. And he says the sower sows the word of God. Then he talks about how, well, all this stuff happens. The devil does what he can to try and steal the word and mess you up and so on and so forth. He said, but it is possible to see 30, 60, 100-fold results of the word. However, you have to, and if you combine Matthew 13, 23, Mark 4, 20, Luke 8, 15, here's what you see you have to do as far as the word is concerned. You have to hear. You have to, faith comes by hearing by the Word of God. So yeah, you have to hear, but you have to have an honest and a good heart, which means you have to be teachable. You have to be open to correction. Healing is not for today. Okay, well, now I'm starting to rethink that, and I realize, okay, healing is for today. And then not only that, but you have to receive it. You have to receive it. You have to keep it. That means you're not going to dismiss it just because somebody comes along and says, well, that's not true. Or, I mean, you have to keep it. You have to grab a hold of it and keep it. You have to understand it, which means you can't just sit in the service and listen. You need to get into the Word and find out if these things that are taught are true, if these things be so. And then there has to be that patience. And remember, that word patience talks about it doesn't matter what happens. It doesn't matter the circumstances or the trials. The bottom line is, here's what the Word says, and I'm not going to doubt. And remember, I shared with you, when Christians start saying things like, well, you know, I know, you know, by Jesus' stripes I was healed, but I just don't know why I'm healed. Okay, you don't have it settled in your heart. You don't have it settled. And the circumstances of the affliction are causing you to begin to release what you claim that you believe. This kind of faith, remember Jesus, the apostles, they're in the boat's filling up with water. By every circumstance, everything visible, everything being experienced, the boat was going to sink. These were people who had been on boats before. They were fishermen. They understood these things. And they went and got Jesus. Look, you know, aren't you concerned? We're sinking here. We're going to die. And so Jesus, when he woke up, he stands up. Now, you know, when he stood up in the boat, he's standing up in knee-deep water or waist-deep water. I don't know how big that ship was. He's sloshing around in the same water. He could see the water coming up over the sides of the ship. He saw everything they saw. But instead of being worked up over it and saying, boys, you got another bucket? I'll help. No. He says, peace, be still. The wind and the waves stopped. He wasn't worried. Now, after it stopped, I guarantee you they had to, you know, keep bailing the water that was already in the boat to get it out. He may have helped, or he may have gone back, laid down, and gone back to sleep. I don't know. The point I'm making is this. That kind of faith, it's not going to look for a bucket to bail as being the solution to every problem. Get this? If the doctor says, well, here are the test results, and you've got about 30 minutes. You got your insurance card handy? You know what? You don't panic. You don't. It doesn't matter what happens in the natural, you don't panic. And you stand on the Word of God. You say, well, yeah, but I mean, what if I end up dying? Then you die standing on the Word of God. You understand what I'm saying? Amen. Like the Apostle Paul said, you know, well, for to me, to live as Christ and to die as gain. Because he had come to that place of realizing, whether I'm here or there, I still win, either way. See, that's the kind of faith that we have to walk in. Now, look in Matthew chapter 13. When we talk about this kind of faith, it almost seems far-fetched. Because it can sound like we're going against everything in the natural. Well, no, not really. But what we're doing is acknowledging there's something greater than the natural. I mean, the natural's there, you know? It's there. The water was in the boat. The storm was there. It was there. The diagnosis is the diagnosis. The balance in the checkbook is the balance in the checkbook. That's it. That's the natural. But there's something greater. And that something greater is the Word of God, and the Word of God will get us to the place of not altering people, not forcing change in their minds, but living differently than what the natural says we should be living. Now, in Matthew chapter 13, look at verse 31. Another parable put he forth unto them. This is Jesus. He said, the kingdom of heaven is like to a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds, but when it is grown, it is the greatest among herbs, and becometh a tree, so that the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof. Now turn over to Mark chapter 4. Because in Mark chapter 4, we have the same parable, the same story, but it's worded a little bit differently. Now, when we get to Mark chapter 4, and you're probably there by now, I'm going to tell you what verses to look at. But when I read this, I'm going to be reading the combined Matthew 13 and Mark chapter 4 renderings of what Jesus said. So Mark chapter 4, you'll be reading in verses 30 through 32. Another parable put he forth unto them, saying, whereunto shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or with what comparison shall we compare it? The kingdom of heaven is like to a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in the earth in his field, which, when it is sown, is less than all the seeds that be in the earth. Indeed, is the least of all seeds. But when it is sown, it groweth up. When it is grown, it is the greatest among herbs, and becometh a tree, and shooteth out great branches, so that the birds, the fowls of the air, come and lodge in the branches thereof, under the shadow of it. Now notice what's happening. He's trying to use a natural example to teach a kingdom principle. What is the kingdom principle? Well, basically, it's the power of God's work in operation in the life of a believer, because this is a kingdom principle. It's a kingdom teaching. Another way to say that would be faith, the operation of faith, the development of faith. Now, he says, how can we compare? What's a good way to come up with an analogy of the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven? Same thing. And he says, well, it's kind of like a grain of mustard seed. A man took it, sowed it in the ground, and, you know, that mustard seed compared to everything else that a farmer would plant is the smallest of all. But it starts to grow. And as it begins to grow, it gets bigger and bigger. It begins to shoot out great branches so that it actually becomes bigger than, say, the corn plant or the beanstalk. Or it becomes bigger than, you know, the soybeans or the beets or whatever else the farmer plants. It becomes bigger than all. It started out smaller. In comparison, the mustard seed was smaller than everything else around it. But once it was planted and it began to grow. Now, what does it take for things to grow? Well, fertilizer and water, you know, simply put, and light, sunshine. Well, it begins to grow. So therefore, we know that that seed was getting some kind of fertilization, whether stuff that was already in the ground, nutrients in the ground, or the farmer added it. It was also getting water, whether the farmer had irrigated or, you know, a good season of rain and so forth. But it was also getting sunlight. So we know that all of those things were happening. Even, you say, well, Scripture doesn't say that. I know Scripture doesn't say that. That's because when Jesus was teaching that, he wasn't teaching a bunch of morons who had no clue about stuff that grows. They all knew. You plant a seed, this is how it grows. They knew it. They weren't goofy. I mean, honestly, you know, sometimes when God puts things in his word, he just assumes that we're going to understand certain things. So when you sow a seed, you got to have some kind of nutrients. You got to have sunlight. You got to have water. So here this mustard seed is sown, and it starts out smaller. Now listen to this. It starts out smaller than everything else around it. But then it begins to grow. And as it begins to grow, for a while, well, it's showing some progress, but everything else is bigger. But it keeps growing. And then it's like the same height as the corn. Like, wow, this is interesting. But then it keeps growing. It doesn't stop. And it becomes so big, it is overshadowing everything else around it. And it's so big that the birds come and they lodge in it and under the shadow of it. Now, there's a lot of symbolism here. But, briefly, the birds coming and lodging in it and in the shadow of it, that represents everything that tree can do is coming to pass. And it's no longer smaller than everything around it. It's bigger than everything around it. And it's shooting out branches that will impact. Okay, let's say you plant that mustard seed right smack dab in the middle of your garden. And you got corn on the left and beans on the right and, you know, beets at the front and, I don't know, something else, asparagus in the rear. I don't know. But when that one seed, that one mustard seed grows, it grows so big that it casts a shadow over all the other stuff that's been growing up around it. See that? And what Jesus is trying to get across is the fact the sower sows the word. In fact, here in Mark chapter 4, back up. You see here in Mark chapter 4, verse 14, the sower sows the word. See that? And then verse 20, you know, the good ground, the 30, 60, 100-fold. And then you jump over to verse 30. What shall we liken the kingdom of God? Compare it to verse 31, the grain of mustard seed. Can you see Jesus is still on the same subject? He's still talking about the same thing. Then in verse 26, look at this. He said, so is the kingdom of God, as if a man should cast seed into the ground. Same subject. He's still teaching on the same thing. And should sleep and rise night and day, and the seed should spring and grow up, and he knoweth not how. For the earth bringeth forth fruit of herself, first the blade, then the ear, after that the full corn in the ear. But when the fruit is brought forth, immediately he putteth in the sickle, because the harvest is come. So what Jesus is doing, he's using different kinds of agriculture to try to drive home to people a visualization of what faith and the word can do. Now you'll notice in verse 26, it's talking 26 through 29, it's talking about corn. Well, you know, 30 through 32, he's talking about the mustard seed. But 26 through 29, here's the man, he casts a seed into the ground. He sleeps. And he gets up night and day, day and night, night and day. And the seed begins to grow. And Jesus is saying, if you go to that man and you ask him, how is this happening? He'll say, well, I put the seed in the ground and I had added, you know, some fertilizer. I'm watering it. And the sun, you know, we're getting pretty good sunlight. I don't know. I mean, that's all I'm doing. I don't know how it's growing. I don't know what. I put a seed in there. I didn't go dig up a whole tree and put it in there. I didn't, you know, dig up somebody else's corn stalk and come over and, you know, plant it. All I did was put a seed in there. That's it. Just a seed. And now, here it is. I don't know. Well, today, science can tell us that within the DNA structure of the seed is the potential for the stalk and the ear and the corn, or, you know, the mustard seed concept. You know, the potential for that is in the DNA. So you take the little seed, whatever it is, the apple seed, the bean seed, any seed, all right, the corn, mustard seed, you take it, you put it in the ground, and the DNA in that seed has the potential to cause that little bitty thing you put in the dirt to become something you benefit from. Now, science will tell you that. And if you ask science, well, okay, then how'd that potential get in there? And they're going to say, well, Evolution has a strange way of it. Yeah, right. Evolution. Evolution is a fool's way of trying to explain God. God is the one who put the potential of that seed in that seed. The potential for the corn. You take one little seed of corn, you plant it in there, you get a corn stalk. How many ears? 6, 8, 12 ears of corn? Some years you get a bumper crop. You harvest them all, and here comes some more. The potential is in that seed to do all that. All of it. What Jesus is trying to get across is that the sower sows the word. And the word is like a seed that is sown in the individual. And the word as a seed has the potential to grow into healing. Get this? To grow into peace. To grow into provision. You follow what I'm saying? See, that's the potential. We look at the seed, and you know what I see? I see black ink and red ink on white paper. Now, that's what I see, but that's the seed. And in our minds, we can say, I get it, but I don't get it. What's it saying here? It says, verse 27, the seed, it springs and grows up. He knoweth not how. He can't explain it. Neither can you when it comes to the Word of God, and neither can I. Nobody can go to a board and write out the formula to explain why it is that the seed sown, the seed of the word sown in the individual has the potential to become all the healing that we need. God sent His word and healed them and delivered them from all their destructions. You know, put your faith in God, believe in Him, trust in Him and all of His benefits, who healeth all thy diseases. Jesus is the Word made flesh. So here we take the Word of God and we begin to put it in us, and we don't know how it does this. We don't get it. How does it produce in me the faith for my healing? The faith for my this, the faith for that. How does it do it? I don't know. I just know this. Contained within the DNA of the Word is the potential. But I can't tell you how it happened. I just know God's the one who made it. God's the one who did it. And so here it is. Now, if that farmer plants that seed and he gets up the next day and goes out there and looks, and he says, What? I planted it right there. What's the deal? And digs it up, looks at it, and this seed ain't worth nothing. Goes, gets another one, plants it. The next day, digs it up. This seed is supposed to grow. And he goes goes down to the farm supply house. He says, you know what? I planted that corn, and I haven't seen anything. And then the guy that runs the farm supply house says, you just came in here 4 days ago. Don't you understand? Now listen to this. There is a season for growth. And when the season of growth is complete, then you can harvest what the seed produces. Guys, this is the message that Jesus is trying to get across to us. It's the same thing. But if we're not doing our part relative to the sowing of the word, how can we expect to get any results? And this is where a lot of Christians, we're missing it. It's like, but I know the Word of God is true. Remember earlier in this series, I explained how that agreement with the Word of God is not faith. That just means you agree that the Word of God is true. Romans 10:17. Well, in that passage of Romans chapter 10, the focus is on people being born again. And so where it says faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God, it's faith to believe in Jesus Christ. I hear the Word of God, I need Jesus, need to be born again, so I hear that, and I get born again. All right, but remember I shared with you, That doesn't work for everybody. And you know, you have a room of a thousand atheists. I don't believe in God. Well, then you go through the Bible and you have the greatest evangelist preacher in the world. Break it down in Scripture. Here's what happened in Genesis, and here's what's going on in you, and here's what you need, and here's why Jesus, and so on and so forth. And out of those thousand, they all heard the same message. 500 get born again, 500 leave, wondering, why did I waste my time? And they live the rest of their life never accepting Jesus. But they heard. They heard. They heard. But they didn't receive it. And so here we are. We can say, yeah, I was sitting in that sermon and I heard the preacher say that by Jesus' stripes you were healed. Okay. But what are you going to do with it beyond that? When you walk out the door, now what? I heard the preacher say that God wants us blessed and wants us to be able to pay our bills and so forth. I heard the preacher say that. And he showed it to me in the Word of God. Well, then when you walk out, what are you going to do? You heard a sermon, but you have to be a sower. I have to be a sower. I have to get this Word in me. And that's why, you know, a lot of Christians, it's almost like because I agree that the Word of God is true, I don't need to keep sowing because I'm already in agreement. Okay. In Romans chapter 10, it talks about you got to believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that God raised him from the dead and so forth. Okay, you know who believes that? Listen to me. You know who believes that? Demons. They believe it. They know he was crucified. They know he died. They know he rose from the dead. And if you were to go up to a demon and say, excuse me, but do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God? He's going to say, yeah. How do I know that? Because when you go through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there were times when Jesus confronted devils and they called him the Son of God. I know who you are, Jesus, the Son of God, the Holy One. They knew. But they're not born again, and they're not going to be. Okay, for us, we're born again, so we're on the right path. But now we've got to do what we need to do to get the faith to begin to develop. And it requires patience. Remember this fellow here, verse 27. The seed is growing, but he doesn't know how. He just knows it's supposed to do it. So he sows it. The patience, and remember that word patience, hupomone. Persevering, remaining, established, bearing up, endurance, the quality of character which does not allow one to surrender or succumb to circumstances or trials. Get that? That's the patience that's necessary for our faith. Now let's think about this whole aspect of the development of our faith. What is it going to take? Another way to say that would be, what do I see in Scripture relative to this whole issue of faith? All right, well, briefly, take a look at this. Go back to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. See, when it comes to the whole subject of faith and getting faith results and so forth, the Bible tells us it works. So therefore, it works. But just because I say, that's right, the Bible says faith works, doesn't mean faith is working in me. Not only does the Bible tell us that faith works, but the Bible also tells us how to get to the place where faith is working in our lives. Now, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Now look over in Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Another way to say that would be, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith authored in me by Jesus, who will also finish it. Now, we also know Romans 1:17, you know, just shall live by faith. 2 Corinthians 5:7, walk by faith, not by sight. Now, this is relative to believers. And what that means is this. The faith that we're supposed to be living by is not the same faith that the people in Hebrews 11 lived by. Abraham, Joshua, you know, all the rest of the people in Hebrews 11, the faith we're supposed to be living by is not the same kind of faith that anybody lived by in the Old Testament. Why is that? Because we are supposed to be living by the faith that is authored and finished in us by Jesus Christ. Well, Jesus wasn't able to author and finish faith in anybody in the Old Testament. So what that means is the people in the Old Testament, regardless of how many great and incredible things they accomplished by faith, they did not have the Jesus kind of faith that we as believers have. Now, the moment we get born again, in fact, I think this is in 1 Peter. 1 Peter, turn over there. I want to show you something. Lord just reminded me of this verse. 1 Peter, and take a look at chapter 1, verse 23. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the Word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. So what we see then is that when we get born again, we are born again by the Word of God, and he refers to it as seed, incorruptible seed. So let's try to create some imagery. The moment that we get born again, we are born again with the life of God in us. Now that life is a seed. But contained within that seed is the potential for Jesus' faith as we live here on earth. The same kind of faith he lived by is the same kind of faith we can live by because the source is that life of God. Before we were born again, we had the potential for faith to believe in Jesus. All those people in the Old Testament, they weren't born again, but they did have great faith potential. But once we become born again, see, that takes us to a whole new level of potential to where now we can do the works of Jesus. You remember there were times in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Jesus is doing things, and people made comments like, nothing like that has ever happened in history. And what they're talking about, they were Jews. And what they're talking about is, okay, I just saw what he did, and I'm thinking back, Genesis, Exodus, let's see here, Psalms, Jeremiah. I'm thinking back to the law, the prophets. I don't remember anywhere anybody did this. Well, that's our potential. In fact, Jesus talked about, you know, your righteousness has to exceed that of the Pharisees, and you have to even be greater than John the Baptist. The least in the kingdom is greater than John the Baptist. And there was nobody greater than John the Baptist born under the law. So now here we have, as Christians, a greater faith potential than any of those people in the Old Testament. That seed of our born-again life contains the ability to live by the faith of Jesus. Now, this brings up a question. Since the potential is there, how do I develop it? What do I have to do? Well, we've already covered one part of this, one aspect of this, and that has to do with the Word. Romans 10:17, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. And then, along with that, Matthew 13, Mark 4, Luke chapter 8, you have to hear it in an honest and good heart. You have to be teachable, receive it, keep it, understand it, and with patience bring forth, okay? So in other words, the Word. So Scripture, God, in Scripture, is revealing to us The potential for this faith is in you the moment you get born again. The instant you're born again, that potential is there. But you're going to have to do something to develop it like that mustard seed so that it grows and becomes greater than all the circumstances you face, greater than all the sickness, greater than all the problems. And one of the things that you're going to have to do is sow the word. Being born again is the start, but you're going to have to sow the word. Get it in you, get it in you, get it in you. You know how people like to make New Year's resolutions? Well, I mean, you can do whatever you want, but one of the things I would suggest is set a goal. Set a goal for how much scripture you're going to read every day. Here's what one person did. They took a look in their Bible. How many pages are there in the New Testament of my Bible? And they divided it by, I think it was like 10. I'll read 10 pages every day. And that came out to how many days it was going to take them to read the whole New Testament. Now, that's just one suggestion. You don't have to do it that way. But the point I'm making is, if we don't sow the word, then this first aspect of faith development is not taking place. So I need to sow the word. All right, what else? Look over in Matthew chapter 17. Now in Matthew chapter 17, it starts out with what's referred to as the transfiguration. Peter, James, and John go with Jesus up to the mount, and Moses and Elijah appear, and those two and Jesus, they're glowing and so forth. And then they come back down the mountain, and there's a multitude, a man whose son has a devil, and Jesus casts that devil out. And the disciples ask, well, how come we couldn't do it? And Jesus says in verse 20, Matthew 17, verse 20, because of your unbelief. Another way to say that is because of your lack of faith. And then he says, look, if you had faith like the grain of mustard seed, looky there. More seed teaching. If you had a faith like the grain of mustard seed, then here's what would happen. It would grow. And now, earlier, he's already talked about the whole grow and be like a tree. So he's reminding them of what he's already talked about concerning the mustard seed being the tree that grows greater than everything. And he's saying, it's almost like he's saying, fellas, remember what I told you about, you know, the mustard seed. All right, if you had faith like this mustard seed, it would grow to the point of being greater than this devil that seems like an insurmountable mountain to you right now. And I'm telling you that if you get your faith developed to this point, then you're going to be able to say to this mountain, whatever that mountain represents, you know, go, and it will obey you. Poverty, go. Wisdom, come. Are you following this logic? And he says, howbeit, this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. Prayer. All right, look at this. Now somebody would say, well, he's saying that the demon doesn't go out except by prayer and fasting. But they ask him why it didn't go out. Why couldn't we cast him out? He didn't say it's because you haven't prayed and fasted. He said because of your unbelief. So therefore, I need to work on the unbelief. How do I work on the unbelief to get to the place of casting out that kind of devil? Prayer and fasting. So prayer and fasting is going to address the unbelief. Then I turn around and I address that devil and I cast it out. Now the prayer. Keep your finger here in Matthew chapter 17 and turn over to Jude. There's only one chapter, so you don't have a whole lot of choices. Jude chapter 1, verse 20. But ye beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, how do I do that? Praying in the Holy Ghost. All right, so what do I see? I'm seeing that when it comes to faith, I need to sow the word, sow the word, sow the word, sow the word. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word, sow the word, sow the word, sow the word. Then I begin to pray in tongues, and as I'm doing that, I'm building myself up on my most holy faith. I'm building myself up. Remember the analogy of the tree becomes greater than everything else around it? I'm building myself up on my most holy faith so that now I am looking down on the circumstances and the problems, and I understand they're conquered. They're under my feet. Building yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Praying in the Holy Spirit, praying in tongues, is the only kind of prayer that is 100% void of all emotion, all tradition, all wrong doctrine, all self-centered desires. It is completely void of anything that is contradictory to the Word of God. When you pray in tongues, you cannot pray amiss. It's impossible. You are praying the perfect Word and will of Almighty God. Praying with the understanding cannot ever do that. Because praying with the understanding is limited to what? Our understanding. That means I can only pray the will of God to the point I understand it. But when I'm praying in tongues, I'm praying beyond what my humanness comprehends. Look over in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Just look at one verse, verse 14. For if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prayeth, but my understanding is unfruitful. As I'm praying in tongues, my spirit is praying. Now you're going to have a lot of people, some have actually been here before, tell me, in essence, I get the same results when I pray with the understanding. But there's no scripture for that. There's nothing in the Bible to confirm that. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. So what you're telling me then is you don't have faith. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. The Word of God says you pray in the Holy Ghost, you build yourself up on your most holy faith. And when you're praying in tongues, your spirit is praying. Okay, that is what the Word of God says. But if I am moving that out and I am allowing the sermons of an unbeliever, I'm not saying it like a non-Christian, but somebody who doesn't believe this, if I let their sermons convince me that that kind of prayer is not necessary and that I can accomplish the same thing praying with the understanding, my question would be, find it in Scripture and show me. Show me in the Word of God where I don't need to pray in tongues. Show me how I can build myself up on my most holy faith without praying in the Spirit. Praying in the Spirit is the only kind of prayer that builds us up on our most holy faith. Now, don't misunderstand me and think that I'm saying praying with the understanding is worthless, because I'm not. The Apostle Paul in the next verse says, what is it then? I will pray with the Spirit and I will pray with the understanding also. So yes, there's benefit to both. But praying in tongues builds us up on our most holy faith. So now, when it comes to me, born again, the seed of God's life in me, and in that seed is the potential to live by the Jesus kind of faith that I see in Scripture, then I know that I need to sow the Word of God. I can't get away from it. I have to sow the Word of God. But then I need to pray in tongues. I need to pray in the Spirit. But what else? Well, go back over there to Matthew chapter 17. Howbeit, verse 21, howbeit this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. Fasting needs to be included. Jesus fasted. The Apostle Paul fasted. Jesus even made him... He made the statement, and I'm not going to go off on this one, but he made the statement that, you know, if you're going to be my disciple, you will fast. A disciple is a disciplined follower. Now, what this means is that if we're not fasting, then we're not the disciple we think. I don't agree with that. All right, we'll take it up with Jesus. He's the one that said it. That's not on me. Jesus is the one that said it. Remember, they came to him and they said, how come your disciples don't fast when the disciples of John and the Pharisees fast? And Jesus said, well, they don't need to as long as I'm here. But when I'm gone, then my disciples will fast. Well, okay, he's gone. That means I need to be doing some fasting of some kind. Aren't you looking forward to next month? Glory to God. And it should be more than just 1 month. We understand that, okay? And I'm as guilty as anybody else, but more guilty maybe than any of you. But fasting, because what fasting does, okay, fasting, when we eat, scriptural fasting has to do with food. When we fast, what we're doing is we're dealing with one of the most incredibly driving forces in our body. That, you know, food. I want to eat. Okay, I get it. So do I. No, I mean right now, Brother Martin. Okay, well, we'll dismiss in a little bit here. All right. So what's happening is when we fast, what we're doing is we are attacking an area of the flesh that is absolutely dominant in our lives. Here's a good example. Remember Jacob and Esau? Remember that story? I'm going to die. I'm going to die. Oh, Esau, I'm feeling it. No, make me some soup. Well, you know, I tell you what, you sign your birthright over to me and I'll make you some soup. I don't care. You can have it all. I'm hungry. And after his belly's full, he's like, wait a minute. This isn't right. Fasting is us attacking that area of our body and bringing it into submission. Because if we can bring the area of eating into submission, then we're going to be able to bring into submission basically every other area of the flesh. Okay, you go to a starving man. I mean, this guy, he's starving. He hasn't had anything to eat. He's starving. He knows. I'm you know, leaning over in that direction. Like Kathy's grandfather used to say, I got one foot in the grave and the other on a banana peel. I'm on my way out. Starving! And you bring some, you know, hotsy-totsy, barely clothed super babe and say, okay, you can have this steak dinner, or you can have her. You know what Mr. Starving Man's going to do, don't you? He's going for the steak dinner. Because he knows if I'm dead, she ain't doing me any good no ways. And he'll probably ask, can I have her after the dinner? No, sir. It's one or the other. He goes, well, I'm going to eat and take my chances. I'll meet her another day. Do you understand what I'm getting at? A starving person is going to go for the food above everything. So if we can bring that into subjection, then we're going to be able to start conquering anything else in our lives that needs to be conquered, no matter what it is. I'm preaching to me now. You just happen to be here listening. This is one of the reasons why fasting is so critical to this area of walking by faith. It's because the flesh wants to say, nobody can lay hands on the sick. What if I do? And what if it doesn't happen? Okay, that's doubt. That's unbelief. I'm dealing with the unbelief. And so fasting plays a role in dealing with the unbelief. So then when it comes to the whole issue of me developing my faith, like that patience is critical. You can't keep digging up the seed, all right? But I'm going to have to sow the word, sow the word, sow the word. I'm going to have to pray in the Spirit, and there's going to have to be some fasting. Now, somebody might ask, okay, but what about worship? Where does that fit in? And that's a good question. And no, I'm not going to say, come back next week and we'll... No. God's presence in worship. I'm talking the kind of worship that comes from the heart. It emphasizes the reality of who He is and everything He's promised. This whole aspect of worship, it brings, like a reassurance that His Word is as real as who He is right now in this time of worship. So yeah, worship it impacts our emotions in a most profound way. And it's the emotions that say, I don't want to spend time reading my Bible. I would rather do this. It's the emotions that say, I don't feel like praying in the Spirit. I don't want to do it. I want to do this over here. It's the emotions that say, we are not fasting. I don't care what you say. Those are the emotions working with the flesh. And so the worship helps us to deal with the emotions. Let me say it like this. Worship helps us to bring emotions into subjection. Now, I'm not talking about you just come in to sing a few songs like, oh, that was great. No, I'm talking about when you open up your heart and you start worshiping God like this. So that's how worship has an impact on our faith. But directly, when it comes to the development of it, sowing the word, praying in the Spirit, and then the fasting, those three right there, and then that subcategory of worship fits in as well. Now, we're going to continue in this because we're going to take a look at some of the results of developed faith. And that's not simply a matter of blind eyes open and all this other. Other areas change in our life. And we're going to be taking a look at some of that. But for right now, everybody go ahead and stand. Now, as I mentioned before, you know, next month is going to be a fasting focus month. And I suggest that you begin praying now about how God would want you to fast. Every day? Okay, well then, how does He want you to fast? How would you want to fast every day? You know, talk to Him about it. And obviously, medication, job responsibilities, things like that all play a role. And God knows that. I remember one time when I was teaching on fasting here, I said, you know, have you ever considered fasting for 6 months? Fasting 6 months out of the year. Man, people look at me like, you're crazy. Everybody be dead. It's like, well, no. If you fast a day, eat a day. Fast a day, eat a day. Fast a day, eat a day. Like every other day you fast, by the end of the year, if you add it up, you fasted 6 months. Yeah, it's kind of a trick question, right? I get it. But anyway, these are things that we need to focus on because God wants to use us, not just as individuals, but as a congregation to make an impact on this community. Now, how He wants to do it, man, that's totally up to Him. But what we're doing is getting ourselves ready, more prepared for Him to use us the way He desires. And then we see His results begin to take place. Well, Father, I want to thank You so much for what You said in Your Word. Father, this faith life described in Scripture is real. Now I'm asking You to work on me and everyone here, everybody listening, preparing us for the whole aspect of fasting. Now, Father, there may be people hearing this and they're already professional fasters. They're doing it the way that they're supposed to. But then for the rest of us, Father, we need to work on that. So I'm asking You to work in us to help us be prepared for this fasting. And one of the things the Lord just spoke to me is that worship is going to help you get there. Thank You, Father. Well, Father, Your word has gone forth. It will not return void, but I say it will accomplish everything You sent it forth to accomplish. And Father, my declaration, my confession is, we will be sowers of the word. We will pray in the Spirit. We will fast, and then we'll be worshipers to facilitate all of this. As we leave today, Father, I thank You again that by Jesus' stripes we were healed. And I thank You for healing being a manifested reality in our lives. I thank You for using us to minister healing to other people, that when we lay hands on the sick, they do recover. This is Your word. I praise You for it. And I thank You that just like what You did with the apostles, that Father, when we go forth and we represent You, that you work with and confirm your word with signs following. Thank you for it, Father. And I give you the praise and the glory for your perfect will being accomplished in this ministry and in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful afternoon, and we'll see you this evening.